Organogenesis to an summary of embryogenesis of us. Good morning, kids. Welcome to the second last lecture of the series. In fact, welcome to the last lecture of the journey of the embryo. Right? In the last lecture, we just studied what exactly has happened till the embryo was 28 days old, right? Now I'm going to stop with the putting days on things, because what happens henceforth is essentially just the development of these different germ layers into specific types of tissues, and you know that these tissue systems give rise to a specific type of organs, right? So the period from the 4th to the 8th week is known as the period of embryogenesis, because after that all the basic tissues and the organs have already been laid down, and what happens ahead is just an increase in size and growth, which is characterized mostly by mitosis and of course molecular signaling and differentiation. But a basic differentiation has already occurred by the end of the 8th week, after which the next period now is known as the fetal period. Now, the fetal period is not really asked in undergraduate syllabi, so I just want to not get into that. So today, we shall essentially just be seeing a continuation of what exactly happens in the formation of tissues and which different tissues are derived from which different germ layers. Now, you know about tissues. You just have to open your histology textbook and look at the first few chapters, and that is exactly the answer for the different basic tissues of the body. So you've got epithelium, you've got glandular tissue, then you've got connective tissue, then you've got specialized form of connective tissue such as cartilage, bone, lymphatic tissue, blood, then you've got muscle tissue, and finally you've got a specialized tissue known as neural tissue. So let's see the different kinds of origins of all these tissues and which germ layer they come from. Let's first talk about the fate of the ectoderm. Okay, so now you already have a bit of an idea about the ectoderm, right? You know that the notochord induces the development of the ectoderm into what is known as the neural plate. You've already seen it in the previous lecture, and it would essentially be this region here, correct? Now, in the neural plate appears a groove that is known as the neural groove. You can see that here. And then as the groove starts getting deeper, a tube is formed, and that tube is known as your neural tube. You can see that here. While the neural tube is forming, there are certain cells that migrate in the dorsolateral and then ventrolateral region. These are known as the neural crest cells. I hope you know about neural crest cells, right? Now, again, all these things we're going to discuss more in detail in the development of the central nervous system. But what you do see here is the migration of the neural crest cells into certain regions, one of them being the suprarenal medulla. Some of them go to form the parasympathetic and sympathetic ganglia, etc., etc. Okay, what remains after the formation of the neural tube is this region over here that is known as the surface ectoderm. So in the diagram below, you can see how the neural tube is completely formed other than the ends, which are cranial and caudal, which are known as the anterior and posterior neuropores. This is about 25 days of age, and everything that you see in this light brown is basically the surface ectoderm. Now the surface ectoderm gives rise to the epidermis of the skin. Remember, the dermis of the skin is derived from the somite mesoderm. So epidermis of the skin, skin, hair, nail, which are known as the integumentary system. So all these things are essentially derived from the ectoderm. Okay, you can see how by the end of 28 days the neural tube is completely inside, and it is going to lie just dorsal to the developing vertebral column, which you'll see that in the next slide. Okay, but before that, let's see the derivatives of the neuroectoderm. So the neuroectoderm gives rise to the formation of the central nervous system, that is the brain and spinal cord, which is essentially evolving from one common neural tube, the retina, the optic nerve in the eye, the olfactory nerve, which is ideally just a continuation of the telencephalon, we shall study all that in CNS, the saculum, cochlea and the utricle and semicircular ducts of the inner ear and the pituitary gland, okay? I want you to have a nice screenshot of this, and you could probably print it out and paste it on your walls. It never hurts to just have a look at these things as you're coming and going. You know what I'm saying? Right. Neural crest cells. Important short note to be discussed again when we study development of CNS, but just make a quick note. Cranial peripheral parasympathetic ganglia, sensory ganglia of cranial nerves, dorsal root ganglia of spinal nerves, all sympathetic ganglia, muscles of the ciliary body in the eye, Schwann cells, melanocytes of the dermis, pia and arachnoid matter, adrenal medulla, parafollicular cells of the thyroid gland, APUD cells of the GID. Some interesting things here, and I hope that you would be curious enough to find out more about all these things, because this is some really interesting information. Last but not the least, the neurocrest cells also contribute to the skeleton of the facial bones and the septa of the heart tissue. So some of them migrate all the way to the facial skeleton, some of them migrate all the way to the heart. And this is some really interesting things, because the migration of neural crest cells, when inhibited by teratogens such as alcohol, gives rise to certain syndromes where the face and the heart are affected together. So, how is the face and the heart being affected? What is the connection? Well, this, my friends, is the connection. Now, derivatives of the ectoderm. As I said before, integumentary system, skin, hair, nails, sweat and sebaceous glands. Now, when you think of glands, you always end up thinking about endoderm. But, well, these are some of the glands that are derived from the ectoderm. That's a cool MCQ. That's a cool question in a practical exam. And when you think of muscle, you think mesoderm, right? But hey, there is an erector pylorum muscle, that is a muscle of the skin that is developed from the ectoderm. In the eye, we have the lens, the corneal epithelium, the conjunctiva, again, the lacrimal gland, the nasolacrimal duct, muscles of the iris, and the retina. In the ear, we have the utricle and saccule, semicircular ducts, epithelium of external auditory meatus, and the outer lining of the tympanum or the middle ear. In the nose, we have the epithelium of the nasal cavity, as well as the paranasal sinuses. In the oral cavity, epithelium of the anterior two-thirds of the tongue, hard palate, parotid glands and ducts, epithelium of the anal canal. And in the urogenital system, we have the epithelium of the distal penile urethra and some parts of the female external genitalia. So again, very interesting to note that the cranial most and the caudal most ends of the primitive gut tube do have an encroachment via the ectoderm, because otherwise the entire primitive gut tube is made from endoderm, right? So I want you to keep in mind these basics, because this is some important information that you can apply and revisit when you study all these systems. Moving on, let's look at the fate of the mesoderm, particularly about somites. And what are somites? They are cubical masses that start arising in the paraxial mesoderm. And you'll say, what do you mean by paraxial? We've been through that. Para is on either side of axis. And what is the axis? Well, the axis is formed by the notochord. So, lying on either side of the notochord, you have these somites. They arrange themselves as donut-shaped in transverse section. And they further differentiate into the dermatome and the myotome and the sclerotome, right? And you can see further stages in the development of a somite and how it gives rise to this situation. And from here, I tried to draw a diagram in the previous lecture. Some students gave me a feedback that it was a very ugly diagram, so I'm sorry. I did not have a stylus, which I have now, so I'm going to try to draw a better diagram. Okay, so we're going to see what happens from here to here. Okay, this little blue colored neural tube, that's going to form the developing spinal cord. Just think of it as we're taking a section somewhere in this region, okay, in the thoracic region. Right, so I'm just going to try to draw a little spinal cord here. That's a developing spinal cord. Right? Then around that, this sclerotome is going to give rise to the entire vertebra. Now you know what a vertebra looks like, but I'm going to draw it again. Okay, the vertebra has the body or the centrum anteriorly. And it has these transverse processes and it has a spinous process. Okay, for those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, you got to start reading a little more because these things have already been discussed before. So all this thing that I just drew is essentially developing from the sclerotome, right? And you see this black thing over here? Yes, that is the remnants of the notochord, and the remnants of the notochord find themselves over here as the nucleus pulposus, right? So when we say that the remnants of the notochord are present inside the body of the vertebra, this is what we're talking about. And then the sclerotome also gives rise to ribs. So in case of the thoracic vertebra, we probably have a rib going something like this. This is also coming from the sclerotome. Then the myotome would give rise to the muscle mass in this area. So the intercostal muscles, the muscles of the back, etc., etc., right? And the dermatome would give rise to the skin lining this region. So I want you to imagine how this gives rise to this, which is literally a transverse section in the mid-thoracic region of an adult. Okay? Now, also remember that you have 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic vertebrae, 5 lumbar vertebrae, the sacrum with 5 parts, and the coccygeal vertebrae, right? So the somites actually are equivalent to the number of the vertebrae. There's a couple more somites towards the caudal end and a few somites in the cranial end, which are known as somitomeres. So let's just go from cranial to caudal. The first or the cranialmost somites, also known as somitomeres, are known as the preoccipital. Okay, now there could be 4 to 5, and these give rise to the extraocular muscles. The myotome of these gives rise to the extraocular muscles. Then you have the occipital somites. The occipital somites gives rise to the musculature of the tongue. Okay, then you've got about 8 cervical somites, which will give rise to the musculature of the neck region. Then you've got 12 thoracic somites, which will give rise to the musculature of the thoracic region. Then you've got 5 lumbar somites and 5 sacral somites, which will give rise to the respective region. And you have about 8 to 10 coccygeal somites, and most of them essentially regress. So you just have about 1 or 2 of them that persist. Okay? Right. The intermediate mesoderm gives rise to the genitourinary system, and the lateral plate mesoderm gives rise to certain structures which we see over here. The derivatives of the mesoderm, the paraxial mesoderm gives rise to skeletal muscles of trunk, limbs, head and neck. The preoccipital, these are the cranial most somitomeres, gives rise to the extraocular muscles. The occipital somitomeres give rise to the muscle. Tongue, rest, everything we already discussed, vertebra, ribs, cranium. Do not forget the contribution of the neural crest cells in the development of the facial skeleton. The dermis of skin, again from the paraxial mesoderm, and the dura mater comes from the paraxial mesoderm, but remember that the arachnoid and the pia mater once again comes from the neural crest cells. All these are little MCQs here and there. Okay, this lecture is going to be mostly like this. It's mostly things that are randomly asked in vivas and MCQs. The intermediate mesoderm gives rise to the genitourinary system. So you got your kidneys, your ureters, trigone of bladder, gonads, genital ducts. The lateral plate gives rise to all these structures. Okay, in bones, it's mostly the appendicular skeleton and the sternum. Then the pleura, pericardium and peritoneal cavities. Then layers in the wall of the GIT, which you shall just study in histology. Don't worry about these right now. The vascular system and the adrenal cortex. Remember, the adrenal medulla, once again, neural crest cells, but the adrenal cortex by the lateral plate. Spleen and the cartilages in the body. Okay, now we are going to speak about the fate of the endoderm. So you do realize that endoderm forms a primitive gut tube after the lateral folding is completed. And this is what the picture looks like. In yellow, you have your gut tube. Around that in red, you have the intraembryonic mesoderm, and the cavity in between is the intraembryonic coelom, which forms the future peritoneal cavity. So the intraembryonic mesoderm that is adherent to the primitive gut tube is known as the visceral mesoderm, formerly known as splanchnopleuric intraembryonic mesoderm. And the intraembryonic mesoderm in connection with the body wall is known as the parietal mesoderm, formerly known as the somatopleuric intraembryonic mesoderm. Okay. Also note that this little double fold under which is hanging your primitive gut tube is known as the dorsal mesentery. Okay. More on that in systemic embryology. Now, if we observe craniochoral folding, then the primitive gut tube appears like this. And now, the connection between the yolk sac, which can be seen here, establishes a further classification of the primitive gut tube into foregut, that is the area lying cranial to this connection, midgut, that is the area at which the connection has occurred. By the way, the connection is the vitellointestinal duct. I'm sure you already know that. Finally, the hindgut, that is what lies caudal to this connection. Okay, so there's a nice diagram here which shows you a little more about each of these. So this area is the foregut, this area is the midgut, and this area is the hindgut. Okay, now we'll see what develops from each of these further in the systemic embryology of the gastrointestinal tract. Okay, also note that the vitelline duct and the allantois, an extension from the hindgut, both end up becoming a part of the future umbilical cord, which we shall discuss in the next lecture. So, these are the derivatives on the endoderm, endothelium and glands of the respiratory tree, endocrine glands, parathyroid, thymocytes of the thymus, follicular cells of the thyroid, in the ear, the pharyngotympanic tube, epithelium, the epithelial lining of the middle ear cavity and the inner lining of the tympanum or the middle ear. In the oral cavity, the epithelial lining of all of these things. Okay, I'm not going to read them out to you, but I just want you to understand how extensively the endoderm contributes to the entire gastrointestinal tract. In the urogenital system, remember the epithelial lining of the urinary bladder, the epithelial lining of the vagina, and the epithelial lining of the female urethra, and most of the male urethra comes from the endoderm. So that's another interesting thing to remember, that while most of the genitourinary system is developed from the intermediate mesoderm, we do have contributions from the endoderm as such. Okay, take a screenshot. Please take a screenshot before I underline all these things so you have a nice, good-looking chart for yourself. Okay, you know how much I love this image because it gives you a nice timeline of what has happened up to day 7. So let's see what's happening. Assume that ovulation happened and fertilization happened 12 to 24 hours after that. So let's just assume that as 0. That's the age. And now by about 30 hours, you have the 2-cell stage. By about 3 days, you have the morula stage. By about 4 days, as things are developing further, we also have the emergence of the blastocoel. And you now have this little inner cell mass, outer cell mass differentiation. And by about the end of the 6th day, the outer cell mass is on its way inside the uterine endometrium, encroaching upon its walls, right? And the inner cell mass is what is going to form the embryonic disc. We are only going to discuss the embryonic disc journey further right now. So by about 7.5 days, you can see that the bilaminar germ disc is formed, right? So that's here. Then you can see over here how the primitive yolk sac has become quite big. This is somewhere around day 9. Okay, then at day 14, you know everything about the primitive streak. The second week is the week of twos, and you know what the twos are by now at this stage, right? So somewhere by the end of the 16th day, the intraembryonic mesoderm has also come. The intraembryonic coelom is formed. And the primitive yolk sac has now become the definitive yolk sac because the cells of the hypoblast replace the Husserl's membrane to form the definitive yolk sac. Okay? Gastrulation will occur after the formation of the primitive streak. Okay? So, by about day 17, the notochordal process has arisen. Also, the allantoic diverticulum has started to be obvious. By day 19, the intraembryonic mesoderm is formed. At the same time, the neural plate has started to develop. Okay. By day 21, the neural groove has been developing, and by the end of 22 days, the neural tube has already started forming. It starts forming in the cervical region, leaving the anterior and posterior cranial neuropores open for a while. At the same time, you can see that the neural crest cells have started migrating to their respective pathways. And at the end of 28 days, this is what your embryo is going to look like. Further ahead, the limb buds have arisen. You can also see the differentiation of fingers happening over here. So that's essentially the journey that we have gone through so far. So that's been a nice journey from day 0 to day 28. And we've also discussed about the different types of tissues and which germ layer contributes to each of them. All right. I want you to keep a screenshot of these tables so you can constantly revise them. Okay. In the next lecture, we're going to be talking about the placenta. Thank you and goodbye.